REACH registration, evaluation and authorization of chemicals. Especially the authorization part is interesting, as you can see on the cartoon. Industry is lining up there for an uncertain future. Are they going to hell or can they enter heaven? I talk about authorization today with one of the companies that is in line currently for authorization, Dominion Scholar Corporation from Canada. Grace Manarang-Pena from DCC is there. She is the Regulatory Affairs and Safety Coordinator of DCC. Also joining us for today's conversation is Linda-Jean Cockroft from EPPA. She's a partner there. And Linda-Jean has been involved as a chair of the DEHP Authorization Task Force. And this task force was the first manufacturing applicant that submitted their authorization at the European Chemical Agency. REACH aims to enhance human health, safety and the environment. Two of your pigments, or I should say DCC pigments, the yellow 34 and the red 104, are CMR classified, and they are used as safety colors on process equipment, vehicles, airports and roads. So very important pigments, basically no alternative available. Those pigments were listed initially on the priority list and then they moved to Annex 14. Were you surprised that they moved to Annex 14?
The yellow 34 and the red 104 have been extensively studied and confirmed by the experts that they present low risk. So in that sense, we were a bit surprised that these pigments are under continuous scrutiny. The other side of that is that these pigments are based on lead and hexavalent chromium. So to that extent, we were not surprised that this would be a focus.
Linda-Jean, how much time did they have to submit the authorization dossier?
They had what is generally available from the time of listing on Annex 14 until the time of the latest application deadline is generally 18 months.
Was that sufficient to involve all your stakeholders, especially the downstream users?
Well, it's very important to get involved in the process very early and enlist the expertise to help us in putting together our authorization dossier. We needed to put together the chemical safety report, the analysis of alternatives, and the socioeconomic analysis. So given that we are a main supplier of organic and inorganic pigments, we are quite knowledgeable, so there was a benefit from that point of view. However, it was still quite a lot of information to put together for our submission.
Do you think that this process enhanced your knowledge and relationship of your downstream users?
Yes, it did, and we have strong relationships with our customers, but again, it gave us some more information and knowledge on how our products are being used and what risk controls are currently in place.
You can request a pre-submission information session, which is informal at the European Chemical Agency in Helsinki. How does this help you in the dossier preparation?
You ask for a pre-submission information session about 6 to 9 months before you're actually going to submit. So by this stage, you've got a fair idea of what your application is going to look like. And it's really great. It gives you an opportunity to discuss with ECHA, with your dossier manager, and with the various experts within ECHA, the details of what it is that you're doing and you're planning to do, and they can give you some feedback on and perhaps some advice if they feel that you need it on different aspects of the way in which the application is going.
Well, in our situation, we found that very beneficial. We were able to understand the methodologies that would be involved in the process.
Grace, why did DCC choose to have the majority of your dossier as non-confidential?
It was important for us to show that we had nothing to hide. These pigments have been tested time and time again. So pigments have shown to have low risk. And we felt that this was an opportunity to educate the public and the other interested parties. Discontinuing their use in the European market is not necessary. They are limited and regulated for use in industrial and professional settings. Mm-hmm. They're not intended for consumer applications. So as such, we feel that the risk control measures are already in place to ensure that the workers are safe and the environments are safe.
Linda-Jean, do all companies go for the non-confidential option, or are there more varieties?
It does vary, and I think it's important to remember that the DCC submission, although it was primarily non-confidential, is also very strictly copyrighted. So it does not mean that somebody else can come along and copy-paste what they submitted and use it in another submission. That's an important point. It's also important that DCC is not a listed company. For many listed companies, the kind of financial information that you need to provide is simply not, cannot be made public. It's either against company policy, and there's a lot of regulation which goes into making sure that that information is kept confidential.
After submission, the public consultation part starts, including confidential comments by NGOs, your competitors, downstream users. After this process, you have the opportunity to comment on the comments. What was the allotted time for this, and was that sufficient?
In our experience during the public consultation process, we received 384 responses. We were given about 2 weeks to comment back on those. We were granted an extension of 1 week. So in terms of the number of responses and the time given to respond, we feel that there just simply wasn't enough time.
Next step is a formal meeting called the Trialogue with the representatives of the Risk Assessment Committee and the Socioeconomic Analysis Committee, and if needed also with the submitters of the comments, where you can share then your comments on the public consultation. Linda-Jean, can you tell us a little bit about such a Trialogue meeting?
Yes, the Trialogue is a very interesting process which has been initiated by ECHA specifically to give the applicants an opportunity to interact with the rapporteurs, which are the leads that are appointed from each of the two committees, the Risk Assessment Committee and the Socioeconomic Analysis Committee. This is not in the regulation. This Trialogue is something that has been set up by ECHA as a kind of experiment in a way, but an additional extra, because the applicants are not allowed to attend the sessions of the committees where their application is discussed, which would normally be the case. The reasons for that are purely procedural. It was considered to be far too complicated to move all the different applicants in and out of these different meetings, and it would be far too time consuming. These trialogues are really valuable to industry, even if the application is quite clear cut and quite straightforward. It gives industry the feeling that they get a chance to have their case actually heard. They get a chance to interact with the people who are forming an opinion on their particular application. So I would really like to urge the authorities to continue with these trialogues. They're invaluable to applicants.
Based on your experiences, do you have any recommendation for other companies?
The recommendation would be to keep all lines of communication open and to keep your customers close and very well informed.
It's one of my recommendations to people who are considering authorization, that they start very early on in the process with a high level analysis of the costs and the benefits of the continued use, because this will give them a very clear indication of the strength of their case, and it will help them to identify which aspects of their authorization dossier that they need to really focus on developing well before they submit.
Now you need to wait for the draft opinion of RAC and SEAC on your authorization request, and then they can tell you if your users are authorized, and if so, for how many years. You're still in this process, so good luck, and I do hope that you're granted at least 7 and maybe 12 years in heaven. Thank you, ladies, for joining us in our CCTV studio today.